Good morning, everybody. We are moving to the next talk. Hello?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Okay. Okay. The next talk will be given by Eric Jan Marinissen, where he'll talk about 3D test and design for test challenges and solutions. Eric is scientific director at IMEC in Louvain, Belgium. His research covers topics as TSV-based 3D stacked ICs, sub-10-nanometer CMOS technology, silicon photonics, and STT MRAMs. He worked also at NXP Semiconductors and Philips Research Laboratories. He holds an MSc degree in computing science and a PhD engineering degree in software technology. He is author of several papers and patents and is very active and served as editor-in-chief of IEEE standard 15.0.0.TM in 2005 on embedded card test access and as founder and chair and currently is vice chair of IEEE standard on 18.0.38.TM 2019. He is also very active in the organization of several workshops and conferences. He serves on the editorial boards of IEEE Design and Test and Journal of Electronic Testing, Theory and Applications. Marinissen was announced by the IEEE International Test Conference, the ITC, as the most cited author of ITC papers over the 20-year period from 1995 to 2019. This is very impressive. And he holds also several best paper awards. He's fellow of IEEE, he's golden core member of IEEE Computer Society, and serves as elect member of the IEEE Computer Society's Board of Governors from the term 2019 to 2021. Eric, it's a pleasure to have you in this edition of the workshop. I ask the audience to pose the questions during the talk using the YouTube chat. And now we are headed to Eric. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for the nice introduction. Yeah, so today I'm going to talk about 3D test and design for test challenges and solutions. Let my mouse in the right computer. This is a talk at the Rio Grande do Sul workshop. So I thought I had to show Shimahan also to show that I'm in the good spirit here for talking to my friends in Port Alegre. What I will be talking about, I will actually first start with a short introduction to IMEC. You know, IMEC is a little bit different from university. It's also different from a company. So it's a different kind of organization, and I want to quickly introduce that to you. Then I will talk about multi-die stacks and advanced packages. And then actually we'll go into the meat of the presentation, which is on 3D test and DFT, where I will talk about wafer probing, design for test, and cost modeling and test flow optimization, all in the scope of 3D chips, right? So that is the meat of the presentation. And then finally we'll conclude. Before I get started, we should put our 3D glasses on then. So sunglasses, I guess it's nice weather in Porto Alegre, and so maybe let's also use the 3D glasses to have a little look at Rio Grande do Sul. So this is actually the last time I was in Rio Grande do Sul, which is already 19 years ago, so it's maybe too long that I've not been there, and I was also in Porto Alegre, where I have very good memories of the Galpão Crioulo. And there's the football stadium of Inter. Maybe here I offend some people because maybe some of you think it should be Grêmio, but we went to the Inter stadium. This is just my relationship to the south of Brazil, right? Now let's get started. Introduction to IMEC. This is a picture of the headquarters, the main building of IMEC, where on the top floors the CEO sits, etc. I also have an office here on the seventh floor. But yeah, now of course I'm at home because, you know, because of Corona, we're not supposed to be at the office. So IMEC is a world-leading independent R&D and innovation hub. It got started in 1984 as a spin-off from the KU Leuven. So initially, maybe we were focused more on, you know, processing chips for Belgian universities, but very quickly we focused. IMEC focused itself on companies. So we do a lot of joint R&D with you know, all the major semiconductor companies in the world. We have, you know, we do work in programs where we work with a lot of companies together. We also have bilateral contracts where we just work one-on-one with companies. We do transfer and license spin-offs. We do IC design and manufacturing services. So we work with a lot of customers, and we call them our partners, but yeah, they're really customers. So the leading semiconductor companies, the IDMs and fabless, I will show you a list of names in a second. Also system companies. So they are the customers, and we also work a lot with suppliers of equipment, materials, and EDA tools. We are very rooted in the industrial world. And the headquarters, as I said, are in Leuven, Belgium, but we also have labs in Ghent in Belgium, Eindhoven in the Netherlands, Hsinchu in Taiwan, Bengaluru in India. So the labs are, you know, where we have engineers working, and we have sales offices also, you know, to be close to our customers on San Francisco, Orlando, Tokyo, Osaka, and Shanghai. So yeah, here you have an aerial picture of our campus in Belgium, in Leuven. So you see again this, this office tower here, and you know, here you see the different fabs. So so here we have, you know, Fab 1, that's the oldest fab where we process 200 millimeter wafers. And then here we have Fab 2 and Fab 3, and there is 200 millimeter wafers, and Fab 3 was supposed to be 450 millimeter wafers, but as that has not really materialized yet, we're also running 200 millimeters there. So we have actually three wafer fabs, and that is, you know, one of our main assets. Actually, if you look at the assets, then, you know, we think, you know, it's the people, so the 3,500 brilliant minds, as our marketing department calls it, including, you know, many industrial residents, so engineers that work for our customers and that, you know, are come to IMEC for 1 year, 2 years. So they work just for us in our projects. We also have quite a lot of PhD students and guest researchers. There's also we also have three wafer fabs, which I already showed, so 200, 300, and again 300 millimeter. And then, you know, if you look at the financial performance of IMEC, you know, it's amazing, you know, growth, and it just keeps on going up. Actually, there was just 1 year where it slowed down a little bit. That was, you know, I joined in 2008, and then shortly thereafter, the profit went a little bit down, but, you know, it just keeps on going up. And actually, most of that money is, you know, from industry, right? So 72% we get from working with companies, and there is some, you know, some regional grant and some European money. And but of course, it would not make sense for the Belgian or the Flemish government to pay for the research that we do for Samsung or Intel. Why should they, right? So this is actually, we have to do industrial relevant work to make sure that we get our money from paying industrial customers. If you look at, you know, the type of topics that we work on, you see here some keywords. So, you know, traditionally IMEC was very focused on the scaling of the CMOS, right? So that we still do a lot in that domain. So we're now at 3 nanometer and 2 nanometer and process nodes, but of course as the scaling, you know, goes more difficult and we're, you know, far at the end of the scaling roadmap, then we also very diversify in doing, you know, 3D silicon photonics all kind of, you know, different, you know, SCT MRAMs and so all kind of different technologies and applications. Here you see some of our partners. So yeah, you see that there's really a who is who in the semiconductor world. So, you know, all the big founders are there, the IDMs are there. So if you look at supplier partners, then there's actually an even larger list. So yeah, these are all companies that we have contracts with, that we get, you know, prototype tools, beta, also beta versions, and then we debug them together with the supplier, and then, so this is how we work with the supplier partners. We have, of course, we have global, our customers are global, so we also have to have a global presence. So, you know, in Belgium are our headquarters in Leuven, But we also have quite a sizable lab in the Netherlands, in Eindhoven, but also in the East, right? So in Osaka and Tokyo in Japan, in Shanghai in China, and in Hsinchu in Taiwan, and in Bangalore in India, and then on the East Coast and the West Coast in Florida and California in the US. If you look at our workforce, that is then of course also very international. So here is actually a plot of the IMEC employees, where they come from, split out of with respect to their home country. Of course, the largest group is the Belgians, because we're in Belgium, so there's many Belgians. The second largest group actually is the Dutch people, so that is, I'm one of them, right? So that is also big group. But then there's several countries where there's also quite a lot from, some countries because they're close to their neighboring countries, some countries because we have many, also our customers come from there, right? So, and actually, if you look at Brazil, here's Brazil, and we have 19. Yeah, this varies over time, but at the moment when this slide was made, we had 19 folks from Brazil working at IMEC. So, so basically, every country in the world is, almost every country in the world is represented at IMEC, which makes for interesting discussion if there is the world soccer contest, for example. If you look here in the FAP, then I don't know why the video isn't running, but there should be a video of the FAP. I don't know why it doesn't want to run. But so we have a full-fledged terminal with a pilot line. Many of the tools that we have are first-of-a-kind prototype equipment. So the serial number 001 of the supplier, and then we debug them and we get to keep them later on. So so you can actually make your own virtual 3D visit to our FAP. If you download the IMEC Clean Room on the Google App Store, and you can just walk around in the way you want to walk around through the different machines and see what they're doing. So that was the introduction to IMEC. Now let's go more technical. So I will start to introduce the multi-die stacks and advanced packages. So actually the CMOS scaling I just talked about, continues, but requires increasing investment. It gets more and more expensive to still be on the scaling roadmap. And that means that less companies can afford this. There is now only TSMC, Intel, Samsung, GlobalFoundries also kind of has stopped on that roadmap. So one day, of course, it will stop also because of technical difficulties. So here you see a picture of the first EUV stepper from ASML, that extreme ultraviolet wafer stepper. The first one was in IMEC, because IMEC is then the place where ASML debugs it and makes it work before it goes to their real customers. And so this is then a representative for the CMOS scaling, but as the CMOS scaling runs out of steam, the baton is being picked up by assembling packaging. To get advanced packaging, we just put more dies on top of each other, in a single package, with TSVs maybe, through silicon wires that connect the front side to the back side, and that we can make higher stacks. We can put chips on interposers, and so we can go both vertical as well as lateral to make more complex packages. And that then continues for the customer to deliver more performance and low power and products. And so Moore's Law needs to continue, right? And if it cannot be done just to CMOS scaling, then it goes in another way. So if you look at the three inter-die interconnects, and very well known is the TSV, the true silicon via. It's actually like a super via that connects the front side to the back side of the silicon substrate. It's not really a true silicon via because a wafer is something like 780 micron thick, almost a millimeter thick, right? And these vias are just 50 micron high. So this is 50 micron. So actually, they just go into the surface of the silicon wafer, right? They are not really true silicon via. So we need to thin down the wafer to make them go through. And so that is you don't want to make the TV then too short, because then the wafer can become too thin as well. Then, but 50 micron is doable. And so even though even though we think that the TSV is actually a very tiny thing and just in the surface of the wafer, actually compared to the transistors that are sitting next to it. So here you see the top of a TSV, so this part, and you see the transistors next to it. You know, the transistors are even a lot smaller, right? Because the TSVs we talk in microns, but with transistors, of course, we talk in nanometers. So TSVs is a very big thing for the chip design and the guys in the wafer fab, but it's very small for assembly and packaging. Actually, the TSVs is not what connects the one chip to the other chip. You know, the actual interconnect between the stack dies are the micro bumps. So they're just like solder bumps, let's say. So this is the bottom bump and this is the top bump that lands on the bottom one. And here you see a cross section, and so here we see, for example, this is at 40 micron pitch, where then the copper bump at the bottom is 25 micron diameter. The top bump that lands on is 50 micron diameter, and then it's copper nickel tin. Now you see that so here we can make this at a pitch of 10 micron. Here the pitch is 40 micron, so that's a factor of 16 less in density, right? Because 4 times 4 in the x and the y direction. And so that means that there's a lot of pressure to scale down the micro bumps. And so we're already doing 20 micron, 10 micron, and this just continues. So we're making sure that the pitch is not limited by the micro bumps, right? So if you look at the interconnect pitch scaling at different dimensions, then you could say in the chip we have of course the CMOS or the DRAM circuitry that is nanometer dimensions. But then in order to connect chips we have TSVs. TSVs maybe in 10 micron pitch, right? And we have the micro bumps now in 40 micron pitch, but they need to go down in pitch, and there's a scaling roadmap for that. Then there is, if you want to get out of the chip to the package substrate, then there's the flip chip bumps. There we may be talking around 100, 120 micron pitch. And then if you go to the package balls that connect the package to the printed circuit board or something, there are maybe several hundreds of microns of pitch. So the micro bumps are really small, right? Here you see the micro bumps. They're small compared to the flip chip bumps, and they're again small compared to the package balls. So it's just a big fan out or fan in, in order to get from the outside world, which is quite large, to into the chip, you need to every time zoom in or zoom out if you come out. There's three in 3D stacking. There's three stacking approaches. You can stack dies on dies. So then you first singulate the dies, and then you stack individual dies on individual other dies. Then it's not very industrial operation. It's largely manual operation. But it's, for iMac, it's good for getting quick R&D results. And so you can also make sure that you stack only dies that, if you first test them, that you only stack the dies that have passed the test, right? So that, and you have some kind of a guarantee that maybe results will also be working. There's also, of course, die to wafer. So then that you use the wafer as a substrate. The bottom die sits still in the wafer, and the top die is already singulated out, and then we can do automatic pick and place. So we have pick and place machines that put the dies on the bottom wafer, and then actually the bonding is a thermal compression operation. So we need some time, we need some higher temperature, we need some force, and so then you especially because it needs some time, you can do this for all these dies collectively, right? So then there's also you amortize then the bonding time per die, and that of course is good for the overall throughput time. And also here you can stack only dies that have passed the pre-bond test, right? Because you can actually, if there's a die on the bottom wafer that was not okay, then you can just skip it. Maybe you see that some empty spots, maybe there was a failing die in the bottom wafer. And also the die that you stack on top of them, if they don't pass the test, you just don't stack them, right? So that is good. Because that is actually a problem with the wafer to wafer. If you just stack two wafers on top of each other, and the positive point about it is that you have the highest throughput and, of course, the highest alignment accuracy, because the misalignment is then amortized over all these dies in the wafer. But the dies need to be of the same size. So otherwise, of course, it doesn't work, right? So you can also not avoid to stack bad dies on other bad dies, right? So, or bad dies on good dies. But So there's always some bad dyes in a wafer, and yeah, so you can maybe, you know, do it wafer meshing, so you can try to look at the wafer map and then try to stack two wafers on top of each other, where the wafer maps have the, you know, the highest still set of good dyes, right? But still the compound yield of these wafer to wafer dyes is kind of low. But you know, for example, for memories, wafer to wafer is a good thing, because memories, you can often repair them, you have spare rows and columns, and then the yield after repair is quite high. And of course, the memory is also, they have an identical size, right? So actually, the requirement of the size and the yield, that is actually not a problem for memories. And so they're often wafer to wafer. If you look at the benefits then of multi-die stacks compared to one monolithic IC, so you can do heterogeneous integration, right? You can combine different process technologies. We optimize for digital logic, for memory, for analog, in one product, because you just stack these wafers from different technologies together. You can make a high density and high bandwidth interconnects at low power. Of course, the inter-die connections go through 5-pitch microbump TSVs, interposer wires. They're much faster and much less power hungry than off-chip communication or going to another chip. So this is more like on-chip communication. So that saves a lot of power and energy. And then you can get high component yields. So for example, here is an example of a Xilinx FPGA that was one of the first 3D chips. And so they wanted to have one big FPGA of 6 square centimeters. So in at that moment, a very leading edge technology, which then would mean that the yields would be not very high, actually quite low. And so they have partitioned this one large die of 6 square centimeters into 4 dies of 1.5 square centimeter. And then they test them first, and then only stack the good ones. And then, of course, the yield is a lot higher for these smaller dies. And so that is then a benefit, getting just to partitioning large dies into smaller ones and then optimizing the yield and therefore minimizing the cost. That is a benefit that only can be realized when you do testing, right? So that means that you have to test the dies prior to stacking, so-called notable die testing. So you only stack the dies that have passed the test. And so this is a benefit of 3D stack, multi-die stacks, that only can be realized if you do the proper testing, right? Now some examples of 3D test chips and actual products. So I started with a test chip that we made at IMEC. This was a test chip with no special functionality. We just to test out the technology, where we were stacking 6 dies on top of each other. So there's six dies, and they all need to be interconnected, right? So here you see the cross-section where the TVs are. It actually is already from 2012, I believe, the date is on this picture. Now this is then the Xilinx FPGA. That was the first 3D FPGA, but actually it's not really 3D because those chips are next to each other. They're not on top of each other, but they're on top of what we then call an interposer. That is another chip, maybe in a somewhat older technology that doesn't contain any active material. It's just passive, just interconnects. And that is makes sure that that the different parts of the partitioned FPGA can communicate at low power and high speed. So this was actually sometimes that is called 2.5D because it's not really 3D. It's so people use 2.5D for that. And then so Xilinx was the first one with a product. And so here you see also you see the two stack chips. You see the microbumps in between here, and here you see the package bumps. This is the package substrate. And so here you see also this, the different dimensions from microbumps to package bumps in action. Then, real 3D chip was actually from AMD. This was AMD had a product for the graphical processor chip for the gamer market. And then, so this was the previous product, R9290, and then they came with a new product. And actually, the green dyes are memories, and the red dye is the logic processor from AMD. And so they could reduce the footprint, because you see that the new product is significantly smaller in area. Even though the red chip, the processor that AMD could make, has more area, right? But they achieve this by you know, stacking these memories on top of each other. So we get now stacks of memories, called high bandwidth memory. And so here we have still the graphical processor unit. But yeah, so there's actually the AMD designers had more memory for themselves, and so they could make a faster chip because if they have more area, they can make the chip faster. And still the footprint for the consumer is smaller. So this is a clear benefit. And then, so here again is an iMac test chip, which we call the faux P. So this is fan-out wafer level packaging. This actually is, again, some technology demonstrated. But you see that, we made quite a complex architecture, right? Here are 7 dies that are, connected, and not just in one single tower, but, in a more difficult fashion. And I will talk about it a little bit later as well. So if you look at also press clippings, and you see that there's a lot of attention for this topic. Intel is doing the Foveros. So Intel is also quite active in this. TSMC is active in it. Samsung, all the big players are either have already products out or are working on products out. Or so this is a hot topic in the industry. If you look at testing of these multi-die stacks, then actually I consider the following test moment, test stages. We have pre-mount testing prior to stacking. So then it's before we start stacking, then we have mid-mount test where we, then we have incomplete partial stacks. So maybe if the total stack is 3 dies, then in the mid-mount test, we have just 2 dies stacked on top of each other. And we want to maybe also test that. And the post-mount test is the same, but now the stack is complete, right? So now we have all the 3 dies. And this is just prior to packaging. And the final test is, testing the complete stack, when it's packaged. So if you look at the test challenges, then I will mainly talk about on one hand test flow optimization, so avoiding too much testing or too late testing. But you can see that here maybe you can do a lot of tests, and so maybe you don't want to do too much testing, right? Because that is just then wasting money in test cost. But you also don't want to test too little or too late, because that might also be quite expensive. And with respect to test success, I will talk about test success external to the die, so or at the stack. So this is if you come from a test agreement, you have to get into the chip, and that is typically through probing or through socket, right? And depending whether you're on the naked dies or packaged die. And so there are some challenges with that. And then once you're inside the chip or inside the stack, you need to get to wherever you want the test to be active. And so then you have to propagate your stimuli and your responses through the die in the stack, and that is where we need DFT for, right? To get the data where we need it inside the die. So and external test success, you can see that the first 3 are all with naked die, so you have much more probe technology, wafer probing probably necessary. And of course the final test is only when the chip is in the package, and that is maybe not so different as what we had before. So let's first look at this wafer probing. I will go here over a number of challenges that we have identified that we found in practice also at iMac while testing our 3D chips, and so we have solved them together with our suppliers, right? So one thing is that we need to handle large tape frames on the wafer probe. So what is a tape frame? Tape frame is actually like a metal ring you see here in the background, the picture, where there is a wafer on top of it. So this is a 2mm wafer. And the tape frame, of course, is, here you see a photo. The tape frame is, of course, then larger than the 2mm wafer. So there's a diameter actually of 400mm. There's a standard for that, and it just defines how large this ring is. And on this ring then sits, is spun across the ring, is spun a tape, and there you put the wafer on. And we need that to dice the wafers, to dice the chips out of the wafers, but also for ultra-thin wafers, for example, that have TSVs in them, and that we have tint, then the wafer becomes very flexible, it's like a sheet of paper that can curl up and down. And so we want to get a carrier for it, and that is then typically a tape frame, right? So So, but if then you want the wave ready tape frame to go in the probe station, then you need to adapt the probe station. You need, because in the probe station there's a chuck, right, where the wafer sits on, and so the tape frame is larger than the chuck. So here we have to, you know, build some extra supports in blue for the tape frame to hold the weight of the tape frame. But the most important thing probably was that we need extra maneuver space. So this is something that you cannot do as an afterthought inside the probe station, because you need to, you know, the probe station from the first conception of its design needs to have the maneuver space to make sure that you can move around. And actually there's also here on the side of the truck sits a camera that is an upward looking camera that looks at the probe needles and that moves in the truck. But yeah, of course, you know, the tape frame, the ring of the tape frame, the metal ring of the tape frame was just in front of the chuck camera. Huh? So you had to also, you know, reposition the chuck camera. So here we have worked with makers of suppliers of probe stations. For example, you know, Form Factor, actually at the time they were still Cascade Microtech, but now they're called Form Factor. And also Tokyo Electron. So this is actually, they're the two leading probe station suppliers. This one in the engineering market and this one in the high volume production market. So to make sure that they can handle these type of tape frames, right? That was necessary for us. And so the Form Factor can load, you know, one tape frame at a time, manual loading through this front port, right? So you just load one tape frame and then you can automatically step over the dies on the tape frame. The Tokyo Electron, because that is for the high volume market, you can even have a cassette that, you know, with tape frames, and it loads just the tape frames, you know, up to 25 tape frames by itself from a cassette. So that is one thing that we have solved. And then, you know, if you want to probe on thin wafers or ultra thin wafers on tape frame, yeah, so ultra thin I define as, you know, 50 micron or less. That, of course, we need to thin them to have the TSVs exposed. Now you see, if you have a wafer of 50 micron or less, then you get, you know, it behaves like this, right? It's like a sheet of paper, you can bend it, you can. Actually, if you do this, it doesn't break, right? It still remains working. But yeah, so you cannot probe on this, right? You need some support then. So we use then the tape frames actually just as a carrier for that. But then if you want to probe on it, then you have the, you know, there's the tape. So the frame itself is a metal frame, but the tape is just some kind of plastic, or I don't know exactly what it's made of. And then the thin wafer sits on top of that, right? And then if you start probing, you know, putting force with a probe needle, then yeah, you might have impact on the wafer, on the dies, right? So of course you want with probing good electrical contact and a minimal impact on the other functions of the probe card. So we don't want to have too much damage. So yeah, we have looked at, you know, different types of probe cards, and here for example you see, you know, traditional probe cards, which are cantilever probe cards, so they are like this, and they bulldozer out over your probe mark, over your probe pad, right? So maybe a trace of 25 micron damage. But so we also have vertical probe cards. They you know, press down vertically, they make a much smaller imprint, and so that is then better. And for ultra thin wafers, we preferably work with vertical low force, the MEMS type of probe card. So they're, you know, the most expensive type of probe cards. But yeah, you need that to not damage the things that you want to probe. So you see some different probe technologies. So these are traditional cantilever needles, right? So you see different cantilevers. And the probe marker will be, you know, this bulldozer part, because it just bulldozes out over the pad. Then we have the pyramid. This is a vertical pyramid, so the probe tips are like this, so they come really, you know, straight down. And then we get, you know, this type of probe mark. So of course this is a zoom in picture, but it's a lot smaller than this one. And actually what we have used mainly is the vertical pyramid rocking beam interposer. That is a very special probe card. So there we get, you know, on micro bumps, we get very small And you see that the probe marker is actually very small, just 6 by 1 micron. That is actually, and there's hardly any damage. And so you want it if you start probing on the microbumps, because the microbumps should not be damaged to not mess up the interconnects between the different stack dies, right? So another challenge that we have solved is single-agent dies or die stacks on tape. So we have maybe just after dicing we have it could also be thin dies. We have dies or die stacks on the wafer. And so if it sits on a tape frame, then you have here you see 4 dies. So this is the cross. This is the dicing street between the dies, right? So the dies are already separated, and this is just here you see some 4 dies and the space in between them. So in the center of the wafer chuck, you will have maybe this type of spacing, but at the edge of the wafer chuck, you have the dicing street is larger because the force of the tape they stretch at the outside of the wafer chuck. They stretch more, right? There's more force of the tape, and so that means that so that the dies are not nicely in a grid anymore, right? They're a little bit off the grid because there's difference in probe force. And so another thing that we had is if you have die-to-die stacks and we want to test them, then we don't want to test them one by one, but we pick and place them in a matrix on a carrier, for example, a tape frame. And so here you see pick and place result of such die-to-die stacks. So on a tape frame, and we do that so that we can test them again by stepping over them, right? Instead of doing one die stack at a time, we can just index step over this with the probe station. But this pick and place is not 100% accurate. And so here you see, for example, a die that it's a little bit rotated, right? So it has a rotation of 1.8 degree and might also have some misalignment in X and Y direction. And so so we have often on the tape frames we have dies that are not exactly on the grid, right? So due to tape stress or due to pick and place inaccuracy, we have to find out where they are. And then we have implemented an automated misalignment correction by the prober. So the probe station's job, of course, is to land the probes on the probe targets. So on regular wafers, if you just have a normal wafer, you can step with a fixed index size, and you don't need to worry because the wafer will be very accurate in that index size. But if you have simulated die stacks on the tape, then we have misalignments in X, Y, Z, and theta, and rotation also. And so with form factor, we have worked on auto-correcting the misalignment. So we just take the pattern recognition. We take images of the different dies. We found out how much they're off the normal position, and then we can compensate for that. But traditionally, so the probe position is when the wafer is under this probe card here, and then if you want to look with a camera to the wafer, and there is a plating camera that sits here, right, in the back of the probe station. So every time we had to move back and forth, and that movement would take 6.5 seconds. So just if you want to probe one die, you have 6.5 seconds to move. Then you take the correction image of the wafer, then you move to the probe position, and you exercise the correction, and just the movement would be 6.5 seconds a single trip, so 13 seconds up and down, and then so that cost a lot of time. So actually, we have also made that we can now record all the misalignments on an entire wafer in one go, and then memorize that, and then do the probing. So that saves 13 seconds per die transportation time. That's of course that's an enormous amount of time, and time is money. So what we also wanted to do, we wanted to probe on microbumps. Of course the non-bottom dies, they only have microbumps because they don't have any normal pads anymore. So initially it was thought that it was impossible to probe with conventional probe technology on these microbumps, because for cantilever, the arrays are too big. With cantilever needles, you can only have 2 rows. With vertical probes, vertical probes could not handle the fine pitch, right? So they could not be made at 40 micron pitch. So actually, initially, the idea was, either you don't do pre-mount test, but then you will have a low yield you'll find out that you stack maybe bad dice and good dice, and then you have to throw away the good die as well. We also, you know, what Samsung, for example, did publish this at IDC, at ISCC 2011, they had dedicated to pro patch on you know, to not, because they could not probe on the microbumps, but that also we didn't like, so we said we're going to, you know, work out advanced probe technology to probe on the microbumps. And so we have worked with suppliers of probe technology. And what do we want to probe? So it's actually, you know, the microbumps of 25 and 50 micron diameter at 40 micron pitch, and then, you know, also large arrays. So maybe, you know, wire one is standard in this domain, so that is 1200 bumps. Wire two, 750 bumps. High bandwidth memory, if, you know, over 4000 bumps. So really large arrays and you know, very fine pitch. So actually, for quite some time, we have been. At IMF, we have been the world champion in large array fine pitch probing. Was, yeah, not, you know, for working with suppliers. So we work, for example, with form factor on the pyramid probes. There's actually a very advanced, you know, probe core. So here you have the probe card, and in the middle sits the probe core, and that is, you know, this thing, the metal frame that, you know, has two thin films, membranes over it, and then, you know, here is the tip layer. And then the routing, you know, goes to the edge of the core, and there we connect to the printed circuit board. So, you know, you can also see it. You know, you see the probe tips, and then there is this routing layer that is, yeah, in a thin film technology is being, you know, designed to. And then we have the connections here, what we call the choreos on the four sides that connect to the printed circuit board. So you see the layout where you see the, you know, the choreos connected, and here you see a SAM picture of the probe tips, right? So these probe tips are very small. 6x6 micron, and yeah, so this is not a catalog product yet, and actually for the moment the form factor has decided to put it back on hold, because they think it's still too advanced for the market. But we also worked, you know, so we had several of these probe cores at IMEC, and we also worked with another probe card supplier, Tenenprobe, is the number two probe card supplier. Form factor is number one probe card supplier worldwide. And probes from Italy, and they, yeah, so they made, you know, more traditional vertical probe cards. So you see the top side, you see the bottom side, and then you see, you know, in the middle is this thing where you see, and here are the probe tips. So they're just, yeah. So here you see the probe tips. This is also a YDO2 array, so 6x73 probe tips at 40 micron pitch, and then in four banks, right? So 752 probes in total. Yeah, so that those probe cards also work very well. So, and this is a product which you can just buy at Tenenprobe, right? So, no, so we have used them on a certain test chip here. We had, this is actually a component of this FOP test chip. We had a true package via design, you know, dies of 2x8 square millimeter. But it's YDO2 microbumps, you know, 752 microbumps in four banks on both sides of the die. And so some, yeah, they're typically interconnected, you know, like this, and so, yeah, with TSVs, right? And then yeah, so we had the wafers with 3,000 dies on it. And we tested it on our probe station here for microbump probing. And so we had actually all the challenges that I mentioned before, we had simultaneously. So we had, you know, probing on large tape frames, ultra thin wafers, singulated dies, dense arrays of microbumps, and we also wanted to do the proto-path alignment accuracy assessment. And so what I report now on is, you know, how we did, you know, what automatic corrections we had to do in Tata XMI, and then what are the probe marks and electrical results. So yeah, we could, for example, you know, we could really measure these individual Kelvin TSVs, you know, where we then could find out that they had like a resistance of 50 milliohm. So if you look at the, you know, the wafer map, and you see the theta plotted, and you see the XY translation plotted. So the theta, you see that actually is, you cannot read it, but they all have the same number, apart from the ones which are colored red or blue, right? So actually, yeah, so they all have the same rotation, apart from some that are different. And here you see also that, you know, if you see the XY translation, and that is because of the force of the tape, right? The tape, you know, stresses more on the side of the of the ring. Can you see larger arrows than of displacement, XY translation? But here there seem to be some dice that are going against the direction of the tape, right? So they are kind of the anomalies. There's also, they correspond to these colored dice here. And this is just the normal tape forces. Actually, if you look at the misalignment that we've measured then it goes up to, the largest misalignment in the Y direction is 500 micron. So you have to think that, we're going to probe microbones that are maybe 25 or 50 micron diameter. But the whole die can be 500 micron displaced, right? And so then we still need to correctly probe on these dies. And actually, that worked. Because here you see a microbone, and you see the probe mark sits here. And so we want to probe in the center, but we're just slightly off, right? So this is very good result. And there's then still on dies that have this type of misalignment, right, because of the force of the tape frame. And the fact that we have 3,000 dies, if you would have to do the pattern recognition for every die by itself, then it would cost 13 seconds per die, and that would be almost 12 hours, right? So we save 12 hours test time by just looking at all the misalignments of all the dies in one go and then going there. And so, here you see this electrical results where you see the wafer map results, and again, you cannot really read the values, but green means okay and red means bad. And so, there was this one die here in this particular wafer map that it just wanted to get off it was kind of taking off from the tape, right? So it was, the tape is some kind of sticky tape, but this particular die wanted to fly off. And so you see that it tested red, and that is, of course, what it should be, right? But this is actually, we're very happy with these results. Now let's switch gears and let's talk about the design for test. So now it's more design-oriented. So we have developed at IMEC a 3D DFT architecture. If you have, let's say, for example, three dies that are stacked on top of each other, and this is more architectural picture, then so there might be DFT already in these dies. So we're showing it here with light blue. And then, so what we're going to add in DFT for the 3D DFT is red rows of DFT, and that will basically be, requirements is that we want to support pre-bone testing, so we want to be able to either probe on microbumps and then test this die and then hold the three dies before they're being stacked. But we can also, we might probe on dedicated probe pads as well. And so but the 3D DFT architecture is mostly important when the stack is already there, right? Because then if you want to test, for example, die 3 here at the top, then you need to, you can only access through the package pins then. And you need die 1 and die 2 to work with you to pass on the stimuli, up in the stack and the responses down in the stack, right? So that is, you need cooperative DFT and the different dies to be able to get up and down to the stack with your stimuli and your responses. And you want the test to be a modular test so that you can test the dies, as standalone units. There's not necessarily, will you have one test for the whole stack. And you also want to test the interconnect layers, one by one. So the IMEC architecture actually, has this full issue that we developed in 2010, 11, I think, is based on the IEEE 1500 standard for SoC testing with embedded cores, right? Because you would think that these dies that are in the stack are like embedded dies, it's a little bit similar to an SoC. And so we would leverage the existing DFT features, and what we made is we made a serial TEM, a serial test access mechanism that would send in instructions and so low bandwidth data. And we also implemented, so that's like a small country road, one bit per clock cycle, right? There's only one bit access, so that's why we call it serial, one bit in and out. And then we also have an optional but wider parallel test access mechanism. This is n bits in and out, and n can be usually defined. So you can decide to make n zero and not implement it, or you can make n as wide as you want. And you know, typically you need this parallel mechanism to have, you know, more faster testing and high volume production, right? So this is the freeway in Los Angeles. This traffic, of course, would never be handled by a road here, you know, a country road like this, right? So yeah, so it's important that the test data goes up and down in the stack, right? So yeah, typically we assume that, you know, at the bottom of the stack, we will connect, there's where the tester connects. And so, you know, you need the test data, you know, the stimuli need to be up in the stack. For example, if you want to test die 2, you need to go through die 1 in order to reach die 2. And then the responses of die 2 need to go back down again, the opposite way, right? So in 2010, I used the term test elevators for that. And that is what many people now have been using, even though actually, if I think about it, you know, test people don't like bidirectional buses and stuff like that. So it's actually more test escalators, right? Maybe test elevators was not exactly the best term. And yeah, what we do then is at every die, we give every die a so-called wrapper. So that is actually at the inputs and outputs of the die. So here, you know, this is the functional part of the die, right? And, you know, we actually put something like boundary scan there. So some flip-flop that you can use to both drive and you know, control and observe the inputs and outputs of the die. And so then we can test the die as a standalone unit, right? So we can shield it off from its environment, from the other dies in the stack, and then just test die 2 in this case. But that is what the wrappers will do. Now, the status of IMAX 3D architecture, you know, originally we developed it for logic on logic, but then we also have extended it for, you know, memory on logic, so DRAM on logic. We have, you know, extended it for SoCs, where maybe we have, you know, ARM cores or other IP cores and test data compression. We have extended for not just a single tower stack, but also multiple tower stacks. And for making sure that we can do, you know, the interconnect, the inter-die interconnect test, that it can be done at speed. And, you know, the most recent extension is that we can also do on-chip tolling to mimic, you know, real power consumption conditions. So this has been automated by leading EDA suppliers. Actually, we have worked mainly together with Cadence. And we have, you know, worked on DFT insertion, automatic test pattern generation, test migration. And this has been incorporated in the TSMC reference flows already in 2012 and 2013. Also with these companies, we made test chips. And we have made an iMac in-house demonstrated test chip that was actually with GlobalFoundries and iMac together. And we have also made test chips with TSMC to validate these reference flows, right? So this is already quite some time, but then we said, you know, maybe we need to standardize this, right? Because actually the dies might come from different suppliers, and so we then, you know, worked on a standard. That standards in ITP get just a sequence number, so this we got a sequence number 1838. That is a standard which actually I started. In 2010, we had a study group, and then we started a working group in 2011. Now, I had already my architecture ready, so I thought we'll probably have a standard in, you know, 1, max 2 years. But yeah, standards are very slow, and everybody wants to say something, and not everybody, you know, wanted to use exactly the IMAC architecture. So it has taken till you know, this year, beginning of, you know, March 2020, when the standard was finally released. So there was like 8 years of work in the standard. This is actually a press release from IMAC, where you can see that, you know, all kind of captains of industry from Cadence, from Synopsys, from High Silicon are saying that this is a very important standard for them and that they will really use it. So actually when this press release came out from IMAC, so then there's a lot of media that also jumped on top of it. So yeah, you get all these, you know, press clippings that, you know, everywhere in the world where they're saying, you know, that the standard is out and it will be very important. Here you have actually some people that were in the working group that helped define the standard. This was at ITC November last year, actually, when we heard that the standard was approved, right? So then we're all looking very happy because we know now that the work is from our shoulders. So what is actually 1838? So it specifies mandatory and optional DFT features per die, so that if you, you know, there's also a wrapper, right? So to test the dies in isolation, There's a serial control mechanism so that you can load in instructions to tell the die what it should do. And then there's also a, what we call flexible parallel port. That is the multi-bit test access mechanism. Right? So this is actually very similar to what I had in the iMac architecture. And so the standard is uncertain that if you put multiple compliant dies together, then you get actually an architecture or stack level architecture that should work, and that then you can connect to your tester, and then you can test die 1, 2, or 3. And, so that is actually very similar to what I had in my architecture. If you look at IEEE has actually number of DFT standards, wrapper DFT standards. So there is, for example, a boundary scan standard 1500 and now 1828. If you look at those, then boundary scan is actually meant for board level testing, right? So IEEE standard 1149.1. That is, if you have chips on a board, so the board is green, right? Then you can test the interconnects between the boards. And so that just has a serial path, because, of course, otherwise, in a sense, you would add packet spins. Packet spins are considered to be very expensive. And interconnect testing doesn't need too much pattern. So with little test data and just one pin in and one pin out, boundary scan could do the job, right? So, but to then came IEEE 1500. That is embedded cores in a system on chip. There, you do not only need to test the interconnect between the cores, but you also need to test the cores themselves, right? Because the chip is just produced when you put the SoC in the factory, and then you still need to test all the cores for manufacturing defects. And so a core, of course, might have a lot more data. So IEEE 1500 needed also not only a serial mechanism, but also has a parallel mechanism, multi-bit mechanism. And so that is, but it's actually not very, very well defined, right? It just says you can have it, but the standard doesn't say much about it. So then came 1838. Then we have dies in now we have separate dies that go in a stack. So what here we said, well, we need to test the interconnects, but we also need to test the dies. So that looks like 1500. But in addition, we also need loopback. So if the left hand side is the bottom of the die, then of course, the stimuli cannot not just go from data cannot just go from left to right, because you cannot get on the top side of the die, you cannot get out, right? So you need to loop back to get the responses out. So here you have maybe test the serial test in, and you have then a serial test out. You have a parallel test in and a parallel test out. So that is maybe specific for 3D, right? Actually, what we also allow here is that these wrappers are not exactly on the boundary of the chip. So you might have some combinational logic, what we call a shore logic, in between. So that is actually necessary to be able to do SP testing. So if you look at the three standards in IEEE, then apparently they are being generated every 14 years, because you see there's 14-year intervals between them. And so these are kind of the differences. And 1838, uses some things from 1149.1, uses some things from 1500, also has some things in green from itself, right? So, I think I will skip a little bit, because here are some more slides on the standard, but I will skip a little bit the details. I think you got the hang of it. So actually we always consider that the dies in a stack have like a primary interface and a secondary interface. The primary interface is that connects to the tester, and the secondary interface connection to the this is where the primary interface of the next die plugs in, right? So that is what we consider. And so if you could also have if the tester connects here, then the primary interface and the secondary interface are on the other side, right? Or if you have a 2.5D die stack, then actually the primary and the secondary interface can even be on the same side of the chip, because this is the primary interface and here you have the secondary interface. So this is just terminology to be a little bit implementation independent. And then we have the wrapper cells that are quite similar to what we have seen before. So that is actually being leveraged from IEEE 1500 in the new standard. You can also you can share them with existing wrapper cells. So that is also pretty possible. And so then you can again you can test die 1 or die 2 or die 3 through the serial interface, right? So there's one bit in, one bit out, so it will go a little bit slow. But you can also do it through the parallel interface, and then, you know, so then you have more bandwidth, so the testing will go a lot faster. And so likewise, you can also test the interconnects, so the interconnects between, you know, the die and its environment, between die 1 and die 2, between die 2 and die 3, and through the serial interface, or again, through the parallel interface, right? So there's a lot of reconfiguration and mode setting in there, and that is then done with this, with the serial control mechanism. So that actually, we have leverage from, that is more based on JTAG. So, we have the primary test access port and the secondary test access port, and they plug into each other. And so here you see how that works. That's just based on JTAG, JTAG, the tap controller, and fine state machine. And you can also have multiple powers, right? So you can have multiple bikes stacked on, and then you can just open them or close them as we wish. There's also the flexible parallel port. So the flexible parallel port is the higher bandwidth mechanism. That is also, it's very flexible. You can design a lot of things with it. So, for example, you can change the direction of your test port, right? So you can have, in one mode, maybe it can be 5 going up and 5 going down. And in another mode, there's some others are going up and some others are going down. So you can program a lot with that. I realize that I'm, filling my time, but I have maybe 5 more minutes to say something about test cost modeling. Test cost modeling, if you have maybe a die stack of 3 dies, then maybe they come out of 3 different fabs, right? And you stack die 1 and 2 on top of each other, and then we stack die 3, and then we do packaging, and then we have the customer. So you can, of course, model the cost for this, but so this maybe assumes perfect yield, right? So we know that there's no perfect yield. So actually, in every step, things can go wrong. So maybe you can also have a test after every operation, right? So you can have what we call a pre-bone test after the fab. And so every test, you can either pass the good dies and throw away the bad dies in the bin, right? And so then here we have a mid-bone test, here we have a post-bone test, and this is a final test. So if you do all these tests, then maybe you do too much testing, right? Because then maybe the program becomes too expensive just because of all the test costs. But if you do not enough tests, then maybe you're stacking good dies and bad dies on top of each other, and then you find out later that there was one bad die in your stack, and you need to throw away all the good dies as well. So you want to do some integral cost modeling, where you take the cost of the test execution, but also the rejected parts, and you have to amortize that, you have to get it back from the good stacks that in the end you can sell, right? So we have, together with the Technical University in Delft, we have made a tool called 3D CoStar, where we do some integral cost modeling. We consider design, wafer processing, assembly, test, packaging, also logistics. If you ship your wafers or your dies from one place to another place, that also might have negative impact on yield, and it has cost. So there is a yield per step in all these operations, and also test yield. Test can also be not perfect, right? There's actually test escapes, and so all these costs are modeled, and then we can do a baseline analysis. And you can sweep multiple parameters in along one or two axes as long as they're in lockstep. You can do all kinds of cost analysis. And then what you get out is an estimated test escape rate, so the quality of your test, how much bad devices will still be tested as good. And also the cost per ship stack with a breakdown over dies and operations. So if you see, for example, how that was used, and for this die, we did an analysis where we should probe for pre-bone testing. So this was two active dies on top of a passive interpose, so 2.5 die stack that we made in IMEC. And so here you see some of the key parameters of the cost. And so we actually looked at 3 scenarios. And scenario 1 was in blue, no pre-bone testing, so just blind stacking of these dies and then hoping and praying that the results will be good. Or extra pads, right? Because to do the pre-bone testing or probing on the microbumps. And so the difference here is that here you get extra area for the pads, and so that of course is costly. And here you need these expensive probe cards, because microbump probing is of course, an advanced probe part. So, you know, we assumed that there were 1,200 microbumps, that we could not afford to have 1,200 probe pads, so we only will do 10% of the microbumps as probe pads. So then we had a test interface of only 120. That would already give one extra square millimeter of dye area. So there is less dyes that come out of your wafer, and the yield is a little bit less. The test time will be, you know, 10 times as large, because, you know, the interface is just 10 times smaller, right? But, you know, here we have an expensive probe card, because this probe card already cost 50 cents per touchdown, right? So if you have a probe card of 50,000 euros, and, you know, every touchdown, you can do 100,000 touchdowns, then every touchdown is 50 cents, right? So, you know, so you see then, and here we also assume that there will be a little bit of negative impact on the interconnect yields, you know, after probing, because the microbumps maybe got damaged. We have never really seen it, but this is a little bit pessimistic scenario. And you can compare these three scenarios, and then, you know, the tool then generates this type of numbers, where here we sweep with the dye yield and actually, you know, the defect density. And so here you get the relative cost per passing stack. And we, at 100%, we put, you know, if you have perfect yield and you don't do any testing, right? So that's 100%. And then, you know, the test cost already will be 14.3% of that scenario. And if your yields, you know, go bad, then of course your cost goes up, because then you find many more. This is, you know, if you don't do pre-mon tests, you still do post-mon tests, right? So you still find out in the end that these dyes are bad, you have to throw them away, and that gives a lot of extra cost. Now, if you do the extra pre-bond pads, then it turns out that, you know, that the total cost actually goes up quite a bit, and the fraction of that test is of the total cost is also goes up quite a bit, right? And that is mainly because of the 10 times, the factor 10 test time increase, because we do not afford more pads, and so we get much more test time, and that makes an enormous expensive test. But if you do the microbump probing, then you can see that, you know, the total cost actually, you know, of course, if your yield is 100%, then actually all testing is unnecessary. If you know that it's 100%, but you cannot guarantee that. So then, you know, we have a little bit extra cost. But you see that pretty soon, something like 85% yield, actually probing on the microbumps, you know, starts to pay off in the total cost. And yeah, so this is actually the extra cost for the probing. So you can see, you know, this is some kind of analysis that you can do to find out, you know, should I use these expensive probe cards or not. We also have looked at, you know, all kind of test flow. So actually, if you have more dyes, then you have, of course, you know, more alternatives. You know, the number of tests that you can do grows a lot. And so we have, for example, uses on this fan-out wafer level packaging test chip, where this is the test chip with the 7 dyes, right? So you have here, this is how the stack is being made. And so if you look at the stack flow, then, you know, we can do pre-mon testing. Then after pre-mon testing, you know, we put the dyes on a carrier wafer. And, you know, here, you know, testing is not possible. There's nothing to test. Here it doesn't make sense. But here we can do a pre-mon test, right? So we can test if this partial stack is already okay. Then we put it in a mold. Then, you know, for here there's no accessibility, but here we can test again if the molding, you know, has worked well. Then we actually flip it over on the carry wafer, then we take the carry wafer off. And of course, here you can also not test. But after flipping over, we can probe again. And then actually we put the memory dies on top of it, and then we have to flip over again. And so there's a lot of operations where I have no test access, but here I can test again. So you see that, you know, during the different stack operations, I do not have always test success. I have to really look at the flow and find out where I have test success. And if you look at, yeah, how many different test flows that would give, then you get enormous numbers, right? 10 to the power 18, 10 to the power 34. So this is just considering, you know, should I do it every moment? Should I do a test, yes or no? And so that is enormous amounts of tests. And so you need to be smart about it to optimize your test flows. This is actually what I want to say. So in conclusion, I talked about the, you know, 3D wafer probing feasibility. So we have, you know, 40 micron pitch large microbump arrays, even tint and dyes on a tape frame. And we have been able to probe those with these probe cards, and also probing pick and place dyes on the carrier. You know, TriMet, we have defined and patented and tested in test chips a 3D geocache based on IEEE 1500. Now there is actually since a few months there is the IEEE standard out that it would be a worldwide DFV standard that I think is actually very similar to what we have done in IMAC, but that is now the standard that people should use. And then the test flow optimization, you need quite some cross-modeling to evaluate the trade-offs, because at every test moment you can decide, should I test this die or should I not test this die? And you can easily test too much, but also easily test too little, right? Where can you find more? Of course, the standards you can get from IEEE through IEEE Explorer. You have to pay for that. Unless you have a subscription to standards, then it's for free. And actually, there's also this book from Wiley that is actually quite interesting, almost 500 pages. And if you use this code, you can get at the Wiley website, you can get 20% discount. If you're an IEEE member, then actually you get 35% discount on all Wiley books. So then that would be a better option for you. Finding some acknowledgements at IMAC and at our partners. And then that's it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Eric, for this very interesting talk. We have some questions from the audience. First, Clovis Figenbaum has a general question about yield. He doesn't specify the technology, but he wants you comment. What's the ratio of good and bad dyes in a wafer?
That varies largely, right? So I know of products in them. If you have a very old, mature technology and you have a very small area size, then the yield can be 99 point something percent, right? So then there's actually very many dyes that are good and just a very few that are bad. But yeah, if you have, if now you have maybe 7-nanometer CMOS technology, so very leading edge technology, and you make big chips in that, 1 square centimeter or larger, then the yield will be a lot less than 50%, right? So it depends mainly on the maturity of the technology and on the area size.
Okay. Keeping the subject with yield, I have a question regarding the yield of silicon vias. I suppose, of course, there is a trade-off between the pitch and yield. And if the yield is a problem in silicon vias, my question is if there is some strategy based on tweak with spare vias, for example, to improve yield of silicon interposers.
Yes. So first, I have to say that the process in the making of the vias. When we started that, of course, IMAC is a research institute, so we want to be ahead of the industry, right? So we were among the early ones that did that. Initially, this is quite difficult because you go very deep, right? So it's actually normally in the processing you never go that deep, and so you really need to drill in not physically drill, but you need to drill a hole and then fill it with copper. So there's some processing which is called deep reactive ion etching. That's the process that you use to drill deeper and deeper, and then we make a hole of 50 micron deep, right? And then we have to fill it with liner to make sure that if later we fill it with copper, that the copper will not get into the silicon wafer, right? Because that would not be good. So there is some liner and barrier that protects the copper from entering into the silicon. Initially if you have this very thin kind of small mouth and then a very deep hole, then if you fill it with copper, it gets an overhang, right? So it fills at the top, and it stops at the top, but then at the bottom you have some voids. So so then you need conformal filling. That is actually very important. And so that has been developed by IMAC, but also by others. So I think now the industry knows quite well how to make a TSV and to fill it properly, right? So the yield initially was quite bad on our TSVs, but I think now we have this process very well under control. And so normally we make, actually the key parameter for the TSVs is then what we call the aspect ratio, so the ratio between height and diameter. So normally we do 1 to 10, right? So we make 5 micron diameter and 50 micron height. And so if we can also do aspect ratio 20, but that becomes more expensive than to make, because then the processing takes more time, and that, you know, time is money, so that makes it more expensive. So the aspect ratio is actually is quite important. Now, you can make spare TSVs, right? So extra redundant TSVs that you use in case of that the normal TSVs are not working. The problem with the TSVs is if you have a yield, if there is some defect, then often it is not just one TSV that has a problem, but it's like, you know, maybe a group of TSVs together, right? And so the TSVs are typically designed in a matrix structure. But so if you have one bad one, then you cannot just use the one next to it, right? So and maybe you need to move away a little bit from the area where the problem is to some TSV that is, you know, a little bit outside to and that means that if you make a detour, then of course you get a longer electrical path, so your signal will be slower, and so then you have to, or even in the non-repair case, you have to consider that there might be a repair, so your timing becomes worse, right? Because you either need to make a long detour or you repair with a spare that maybe is also defective. So that is actually an intrinsic problem that I'm not sure if there's really good solutions for that.
Okay, thank you. We have two questions from William Fontenelle. The first one is, can you test multiple dies, parallel testing, with the wafer when the wafer is diced, or after the wafer is diced, only one die can be tested at the same time?
Yeah, that's a good question. So it's quite common in common practice to do testing dies in parallel, right? And so that is the jargon term for that is multi-site testing. So that's the normal term for it. Multi-site testing doesn't mean, you know, testing here and in Japan, you know, there's not multi-site there, but multi-sites on a wafer. So, and you know, it's actually quite common that on a wafer people do, you know, 2x2 testing or 4x4 testing, or it's actually very common. Of course, if now you have these diced dies, then you know, you saw that what happens to the tape frame, right? That there's the dicing street actually is not, doesn't stay the same size, but it gets stretched, and it gets stretched more at the outside ring of the wafer and less at the center of the wafer. So then, you know, I think you cannot develop a probe card that would, you know, would compensate for these differences, right? So I think the one who asked the question is completely right that will kill the multi-site testing. Yes.
Mm-hmm. The second question is, when using a 3D stacking strategy, do you use to test dies using the testability machine inside each die, or you use to concept special dies into the wafer to test a little set of dies, for example?
I'm not sure that I fully got that question.
I suppose that he's asking if you put some testability block inside each die, or if you use some special die near this die to be tested to accomplish the test of the dies.
No, so normally we don't use special dies, right? So it's just we have the material that we have, and we might put, you know, we put DFT inside the dies to bring the testimony, you know, where we want to have them inside the die or inside the die stack. But if there's, you know, the tester can mimic any other functionality that you might need, right? Because you can just freely program, you know, what kind of stimuli you want to get at which clock cycle and what response you expect at which clock cycle. So there will be no need to have another chip inside the tester or something.
Mm-hmm. And the last question is also from William Fontenelle. How do you solder the bumps between dies? Improvise. Which materials you use? You mentioned that is made in high temperature. So he wants to know which materials and how you perform the solder.
So the microbumps that I showed actually are, you know, the bottom microbump is just copper, right? And then the one that lands on top of it is copper nickel tin. So actually there's copper to begin with, and there's a little layer of nickel, and then the solder is the tin, right? So like when you're soldering at home, it's also tin. So that is what we use.
Okay. I thank you again, Eric, for this very nice contribution to the workshop. And this ends his session.